Om Gyanat Nirantasya Gyanam Jana Shalakaya Chakshurin Lilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namah.
Yeah, because you know, because it's a cold country, and then if you say warm, that sounds something very good, but warm welcome. But if here it's already warm, without having to say that, it's automatically warm. I think it was 2 years ago we last came here on with all the devotees. Was it about two years ago? And it was very hot on that day. It's about 45 degrees. Seems that today will be very hot, temperature-wise also. It's also the Pandava Nirjala Ekadashi today, which always comes, it's the last Ekadashi before the southwest monsoon is scheduled. So it's like the hottest time of the year in India. So it's difficult to follow on this day particularly without taking full fasting without taking even water. Of course, in the Madhva Sampradaya, many still follow every Ekadashi without taking water. Who would like to join the Madhva Sampradaya? Well, some devotees in ISKCON do that also. Srila Prabhupada didn't. He would take Anukalpa Prasad, what's what we call Ekadashi Prasad, on every Ekadashi day. So you may do also if you like. If you want to fast fully, you can do so. Don't stand on a big stage and tell everyone that you're doing it. So this is the fifth or sixth time I visited Kanchipuram. Probably many of you have visited more often. Who's visited more than five or six times? Yeah. Not so many. I would have thought more because most of the devotees live quite close to Kanchi. There's a saying in Bengali, Jara Ganga Nikote Take Tara Ganga Shnan Kokono Korena. Means that those who live next to the Ganga, they never take bath in the Ganga. They take in the tube well in their backyard. It's more convenient. It's actually mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam. What is it? I can't remember exactly. Dure Bhaku Ayanam Tirtam. One thinks that one has to go a long distance to go to a holy place. That's one of the symptoms of Kali Yuga. Srila Prabhupada gave an example that people from Calcutta go to bathe in the Ganga in Haridwar, which is maybe 2,000 kilometers away from Calcutta. But the Ganga is flowing through Calcutta. Dure Varyayanam Tirtham. So there are so many holy places in Tamil Nadu. Divya Deshams. Most of them are Divya Deshams, considered the transcendental places according to the Ramanuja Sampradaya. So this may be my fifth or sixth visit here. In Srirangam, more times I visited, and I even spent considerable period of time there. In Udupi, many, many times. And Mayapur and Vrindavan so many times, it's just, can't count at all. And by Srila Prabhupada's grace, I've been able to visit many, many holy places all over India and outside India also. Srila Prabhupada has created so many holy places outside of India. Tirtha Kurvanti Tirthani, this Yudhishthira Maharaj said to Vidura that you, by say a person of your caliber, saint of your caliber, when you go to a holy place, you make it a, when you go to any place, you make it a tirtha. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, of course, also visited here, and Balaram visited here, Nityananda Prabhu visited here. So by traveling by walking around Bharata, the Supreme Lord has purified it. Ramchandra Bhagavan also traveled widely. Ramchandra Bhagavan, of course, his leela is, or this what is now called Tamil Nadu, intimately connected with the Leela of Ramchandra Bhagavan. So not what to speak of the Supreme Lord Himself, even the great devotees who visit the holy places, they who visit any place make it purified, and they make it a holy place. If we, this 26 Second Avenue, Manhattan, New York, is where Srila Prabhupada started the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. And you wouldn't think that a storefront in New York has got anything to do with anything holy whatsoever. But when anyone enters that, I suppose especially a devotee who enters that, you can immediately sense the very strong spiritual vibration because of Srila Prabhupada. He spent so much time there, and he was giving out mercy very extremely liberally there. So like I was saying, I've been fortunate by Srila Prabhupada's mercy to visit many holy places. Once in some place someone was introducing me before a lecture, and they introduced that I'd visited many holy places, and that in my book I'd written that that by Srila Prabhupada's mercy I visited these holy places. Well, that's not exactly what I wrote. I wrote that shelter at his lotus feet is more valuable than visiting millions of holy places. Through the mercy of the devotees, we can connect with Bhagawan, who is Tirthapad. Tirthapad means at whose lotus feet are all the holy places. Otherwise, just like there are so many fish in the Ganga, and they're constant, all their life they're taking Ganga snan, but they don't become spiritually advanced. There may be many devotees who live far away from the holy places in South America, for instance. Most of the devotees in South America, they can't afford ever to, in their whole lives, to come to India. But they can, by connecting through parampara with Bhagawan, they can attain the same destination as persons who spend their whole lives in holy places very seriously practicing Krishna consciousness. So ultimately everything depends upon our state of consciousness. Some people come to Kanchipuram for buying saris. They might visit the temple also, but their main interest is, well, if they're a businessman, and it may be profit, or individually they may be buying for a wedding, something like this. I think Kanchipuram is generally more famous for saris among people in general than for the great spiritual culture which is here and the great temples which are here. Is that true? Maybe the ladies can answer that one. So we've come here to bow our heads to the Supreme Lord, who has appeared here in many forms. There are many temples here. The most famous temples are those of Varadaraj Perumal in Chinna Kanchi, or Little Kanchi. And in Big Kanchi, there's the actually much bigger temple, although the Varadaraj coil is also big, but even much bigger is the, and the whole grounds are huge, of the Ekambarishwar temple of Lord Shiva. So previously, especially in what's now called Tamil Nadu, at that time it wasn't called Tamil Nadu, but previously there was great rivalry between the Shaivas and the Vaishnavas. So I conjecture that one reason they built all these big temples was to show the big temple of Lord Shiva, bigger than Lord Vishnu, is to show, you see, our God's bigger than yours. And in the Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya, they were very strict. The followers of this, the Ramanuja Sampradaya, they would never enter any temple other than a Vishnu temple. Sri Ramanuja instructed his followers that one should never enter any temple except that of Vishnu, even to save oneself from being devoured by a tiger. Previously, there were many tigers all over India. Most of the Tamil tigers are now in Sri Lanka. But you can imagine it's a very frightening situation. If you see, most of the temples will be in the village, and the villages are on the edge of the jungle. So it may be that the tiger comes in looking for some chickens or something to eat and sees you instead and thinks, well, that probably tastes better than a chicken. So if you see a tiger looking at you in a hungry mood, you'll want to take shelter in the nearest building. But if that happens, if that building is a temple not of Vishnu, Ramanuja says, don't go in. Better you get eaten by a tiger. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu presented a different perspective. When Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur related that when he entered the temple of the what's called the Meenakshi temple or Sundaresha temple in Madurai, the priests were very surprised to see him there because they didn't expect to see anyone with Vaishnav Tilak ever entering a temple any other than a Vishnu temple. But Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, at that time, before he took sannyas, Siddhanta Saraswati, he explained to the priest that we enter the temple to offer respect to the demigods, seeing them as great devotees of Vishnu. So we shall also enter the, if the Lord allows us, we also hope to enter the Ekambareshwar Koil. This is also, Kanchi is also intimately connected with the Sampradaya of Sri Ramanujacharya. As a young man, Bhagavan himself brought Ramanuja here. Ramanuja was on pilgrimage with his guru, so-called guru Yadav Prakash, and other students. But this Yadav Prakash, on pilgrimage means they weren't going by bus, they were walking, of course. So Yadav Prakash actually was planning to kill Ramanuja because Yadav Prakash was a Mayavadi. And Ramanuja had been studying Sanskrit from him, but Ramanuja had defeated one of his statements. So what happened one day, Ramanuja was massaging Yadav Prakash. While Yadav Prakash was lying on his stomach, Ramanuja was massaging his back. So while this was going on, Yadav Prakash was explaining from the Upanishads, and he explained one statement where he described Pundarikaksha, the Supreme Lord, his kapyasa, his eyes, well, that's the words, and he explained it according to Shankaracharya's commentary to mean that the eyes of Lord Vishnu look like the red backside of a monkey. So as he was explaining, Yadav Prakash felt some hot drops falling on his back. And he understood that Ramanuja was crying. So he asked him, why are you crying? And Ramanuja replied that this explanation you have given of the Supreme Lord's eyes being like the red backside of a monkey, this is, I find this extremely distasteful. So this was like a challenge to Yadav Prakash. He said, well, that is the explanation of our Acharya. Can you give any better explanation? He didn't expect that Ramanuja could, but Ramanuja did. He explained that the words to mean that this kapi means that which sucks water, which means the lotus. So the eyes of the Lord are like the lotus. It shouldn't be explained in the other way. He said, this is the proper way to understand this. How can you compare the Lord's eyes to the backside of a monkey? So Yadav Prakash was amazed that this young boy has got such insolence. And instead of being happy, he thought that this boy, when he grows older, will be a great obstacle to our Sampradaya. So he plotted to kill Ramanuja. So some days later they announced that we're going to go on pilgrimage to Kashi, which means a long walk, takes several months. So they were passing through the forest, and that evening the Yadav Prakash planned to have Ramanuja killed through some of his other disciples. So the Supreme Lord came in the form of an old Brahmin and warned that now you should... No, there was a storm and Ramanuja became separated. And then he was wandering and wandering, didn't know where he was. And then an old Brahmin directed him, you go this way. And they saw that they'd come out from Kanchipuram, and Ramanuja came back to Kanchipuram by the direction of that Brahmin who was the Supreme Lord. So he was living here for several years and serving the Lord and bowing our heads at his lotus feet. We request his blessings that we can appreciate the Supreme Lord who is kindly manifest here. Some people may see the Lord as stone, but Ramanuja and other devotees, they were actually speaking to the Lord. There were devotees who they were appointed to speak to the Lord. If there's any question you have to ask him, he'll give you the answer. So what a difference. Someone sees stone and someone is directly in contact with the Supreme Lord. So according to our level of consciousness, we will appreciate or not appreciate the Lord. As I was saying, I visited many holy places, but even coming again and again to the same places, I always feel some excitement that again we're coming to this place. It's just you can visit some mundane places. Tourists, they go to mundane places. It's a common pastime in the modern world. People travel around and they visit all mundane places. Where I'm from, London, so many lakhs of people go there every year to see the Houses of Parliament and the Tower Bridge and Westminster Bridge and the Tower of London and Madame Tussauds Wax Museum and all this kind of thing. So once you've been and you've taken a few photos there, then if someone says, you want to go again? No, I've already been there. Next year I'll go to Paris. But we don't say that, I've already been to Kanchipuram, so no need to go again. Rather, we like to go time and time again to imbibe the spiritual atmosphere, whatever is there, and purify our consciousness by taking darshan of the Lord and remembering the wonderful pastimes of the great devotees who have lived here and served the Lord here. A great devotee who... one of the greatest acharyas in the Ramanuja Sampradaya, Vedanta Deshika. He also lived here throughout his life. This is also, Kanchipuram is also the local headquarters of the great opposition to Vaishnavism of the Shankara Sampradaya. Yeah, the Kanchi Kamakoti Pitam is famous as the locals. Pitam literally means seat of the Shankara Sampradaya. So like I was saying, traditionally there's been great rivalry between the Mayavadis and the Vaishnavas. But in these days where everyone pretty much is a gross materialist, serious differences between Vaishnav Siddhanta and the Advaita Siddhanta continue, But still we can appreciate the Shankara Sampradaya sannyasis for their austerity, learning of Shastra, upholding of Vedic culture in various ways. In the modern age, one of the greatest sadhus or genuine sadhus of India lived here. He was the incumbent Shankaracharya or head of the Kanchi Kamakoti Pitam. He passed away when? About 15 years ago? The Chandrasekharendran Saraswati? About 15 years ago, and he was aged, what, 102, yeah. He was aged 102 at the time. So he was vastly learned in Shastra. He followed all the rules of sannyas, just like in all the old days. You would never go anywhere except by walking. Sometimes he would go to Chennai. Now, if you go nowadays by train, it takes, what, 1.5 hours, something like that. But he would walk. That would take a few days. He would, even though he was living, I mean, his mutt is just very close to the Ekambarishva coil, but he wouldn't go there every day. He would walk every day the several kilometers to Varadaraja coil and take darshan of Lord Vishnu. So although he expounded Advaita Siddhanta, which we are completely opposed to, it seems that he also had feelings for Lord Vishnu. And he actually had appreciation for our movement. Of course, you know, not appreciated in the same way as a devotee would, but he did appreciate it. When Bhakti Swarup Damodar Maharaj, one of our ISKCON Acharyas who has now passed away, when he visited Sri Chandrasekharendran Saraswati, the Chandrasekharendran, he said, "May the holy name shine all over the world." Actually, when the devotees first came in, he saw them, he said, "Oh, you've come from Navadvip. Where is your Nimai?" So, although, like I say, I mean, philosophically we oppose tooth and nail, but we can appreciate saintly qualities wherever they appear. To oppose tooth and nail means to oppose very strongly. Tooth and nail means you're fighting by biting and scratching. That's literally what it means. So, yeah, we'll be going out now. Everyone should... I suggest you keep your head covered because we'll be out in the sun. It's going to be hot, especially all our nicely shaven-headed brahmacharis. And keep your head covered, otherwise there's danger of sunstroke. I'd like to invite the kirtan team from Ceylon to take charge of the leading all the kirtans, because although ultimately in kirtan bhav is most important, but it's also good if you can sing in tune and time and play the instruments in time and all this kind of thing. So they have a good kirtan group in Ceylon. The of course Krishna Kirtan Prabhu, he got that name because of his expertise in kirtan, but he's doing kirtan in Ceylon, not here, right now. We have four other members of the core team. I mean, all of them can lead kirtan and play madanga and all this. So all of you can take charge of the kirtan department. There's a saying, bhav is the main thing, but it's just like if you're cooking. You may have a lot of feeling you want to please the Lord, but if you don't know how to, or if you're not very expert in cooking, it won't come out so well. And actually, if you really want to please the Lord, you should try and learn how to cook properly, not just offer burned rice every day. Another point is that some my disciples in Dubai, they offered some contributions so that I could distribute some books freely. So I thought it would be a good idea to distribute Srila Prabhupada's books when we go to the holy places to the brahmanas there. So I wanted to put someone in charge of that. I was thinking someone who's from Brahmana caste. We're not caste conscious, but nevertheless it's nice if people from the Brahmana caste can give to the Devotees who are in this lifetime born in a body of the Brahmana family can give Prabhupada's book to those who are born in Brahmana families, and then those Brahmanas can see that, yeah, well, they're also Brahmin by caste, and now they're Vaishnavas, so maybe I can do the same thing. Satyanarayan Ranga Krishna. Alright, they're both. Do we have any Iyengars? They're both Iyos. Alright, why don't we have one Iyengar and one Iya? Is that alright? It's uniting on a higher principle. All right, well, it's time to go. At each temple, we want to perform a little kirtan. We'll speak a little bit about the mahatmya of the temple, and then like this, there'll be kirtan and katha. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Hare Krishna. Oh, one question. I was in Arcot two nights ago. How do you pronounce it? Arcot. And did anyone make a recording of the lecture I gave? Because the recording didn't come out. Anyone made a... Alright, can you get that recording? Make a point to get that. Stick it in my computer.